the limitation, I think I've stated it, that should be what, five, you shouldn't spend more than $5. So any questions about the project? Of course, there's one part of it which I haven't included in the description. I'm gonna go over that, the exact solution. But if you have any problem, then, so you have 1 week, you submit that next Friday. The exam is due on Monday. I think there was a mistake somewhere. Somebody brought to my attention. Did I say the email exam was also due on Friday? Or something like that? I did?
Yeah.
How about in the write-up? The attachment?
Monday.
Oh, sorry about that. Yeah, the exam is due on Monday. There's only four problems. In all honesty, you can do it in 2-3 hours. Yes?
So next homework is due on Friday as well?
Next, that's a good question. I never...
It's a lot.
It's a lot.
A big homework assignment.
Is that right?
Homework set too.
I'm glad you asked that question. So, do you mind sending me an email? I'll change that.
Thank you.
Just everybody.
Okay, good. Otherwise, it says set two is due the 27th, which is Wednesday.
Thank you. Panic kind of set in last night.
Right.
Yeah.
So, any other questions? So, let me do a few more problems, Rady's method, and then we'll see where we are. Okay. So, as I promised, the course started by introducing the concept of mechanical vibration. What is mechanical vibration? Some basic definitions and terminology, degrees of freedom. Then we introduced the concept of single degree of freedom system as the first approximation of a mechanical system or a structural system modeled to give us a good understanding about some of the fundamental characteristics of a dynamic system, most important of which is natural frequency, which we introduced through introducing a single degree of freedom system. So we didn't do much as far as solving the problem, except that we said, okay, let's first focus on, now that we have introduced the concept of single degree of freedom system, is it possible to model any physical system as a single degree of freedom system? So that's what we've spent the past 2-3 weeks on that. We introduced three major approaches, and the last one has been Rayleigh's method. So I'm gonna do another, maybe one or two problems. I think I did this problem last time, right? This problem, right? I think I did that in this class. So let me do another example. Let's say you have a simply supported beam, which represents maybe a rotating machinery or something like that, with a lumped mass in the center. That can represent a disk, for instance. The beam, though, is not massless. It has a mass or density rho. Rho would be mass density per length. That's how, in fact, in those tables that tabulate exact solution, that's how the mass density is used, because those are based on continuous systems and you want to have a non-dimensionalized derivation, since cross sections may change. So the unit, the mass per length is better. Whatever it is, the density, multiply that by the cross section. And it has, of course, some given rigidity EI. And you want to find the natural frequency of this system. Okay. Let's see how we can use Rayleigh's method. So what I would do, I would consider a coordinate system here, X and Y. So the beam is vibrating along x-axis with respect to y, so it is experiencing a displacement like this. So this is what I would like to consider as the u at any point x. Okay. When we derived Rayleigh's method and basically came with these two expressions or formulas that based on the assumption of shape function and so on, equivalent mass and equivalent stiffness for any simple system can be derived by using these relationships. I don't have it here. I have it in here, and as you can see, I don't even memorize those. The general terms were M equivalent was the integral from 0 to L, mass density, which is a function of x, times phi squared dx plus mi phi squared ai. So this is for the lumped masses. If you have lumped masses, this is for the continuous part, okay? Versus this is a continuous part, the beam, and this is a lumped mass. And k equivalent was the integral from 0 to L of e I x, second derivative of phi with respect to x squared dx plus the effect of those lumped stiffnesses, which is ki times phi, evaluated at the location of each of those strings squared. So we came up with these results using the principle, the conservation of energy. So you don't have to derive that every time. This is what you can use to find the equivalent mass and equivalent stiffness, and therefore find the natural frequency. So let's use that in here. What I will do in this case, since the structure is symmetric with respect to this line of symmetry, I would consider, in terms of the integration, would be overall evaluation would be a lot easier if I set the origin here, consider half of this. Remember, phi of x is what I call the shape function. This comes from, based on the analogy with the static deformation. So for instance, for a cantilever beam, we saw that what it was. For a cantilever beam, phi of x was 3 half x over L squared minus 1 half x over L cubed, which came based on, okay, displacement due to a load at the tip of the beam, which describes the qualitative shape of the deformation even when the beam is subjected to a dynamic displacement. For a simply supported beam, which is what we have here, since the mode of vibration is like this, which is resembles the static displacement under a concentrated load in the middle of the beam, this, okay, this is P over 48 EI times L cubed minus 6 LX squared plus 4X cubed. Okay. You're not expected to remember these or even derive them. These are all tabulated in the back of your strength of material textbook or whatever table you can find. But if you're interested to derive them, you remember there were two ways to derive them. One of them was this, right? You remember this differential equation for the bending of a beam, where you needed two initial conditions plus the initial conditions. Okay, so that's how you, yes?
What is the force P multiplied by the shape function of the simplicity of
P? P is a force, right? So this is the static displacement, okay? So you look at this static displacement, and you say, if I want to extend this to the dynamic case, or the phi function that I need for Rayleigh's method, this describes a qualitative shape of the dynamic displacement. So I don't care about this part. This is all I need. So for this case, for the Rayleigh's method, this is the shape function that I'm going to use. Which was based on the assumption that you have a mass here which dominates basically the dynamic motion of this. Okay? And same thing here. So in this case, that's what we're going to use. So let's do that. Let's just substitute that in here. And as I said, I take advantage of the symmetry. So I will set up these integral versus for MEQ for the half of that beam. So 0 to L over 2 of rho of x, okay, times phi squared, or phi of x squared dx, plus I m I phi squared a I. A is the location of the lumped mass with respect to that origin. Yes?
The difference between those two graphs, or those...
You mean these two?
Yeah.
Now this is for a cantilever, and this is some discipline.
Would you imagine that the first one is like half short, or like a...
No, because this is fixed, and this is simply supported.
So right. We're assuming that both have a total length of L?
Yeah, in the general formula, yeah, we call this L and this L, but this L has nothing to do with this L, just parameter. So any, yes?
Is the summed equation MI B squared at A of I?
At A of I, correct, yes. That's correct. So evaluate it at A of I. So versus in this case then, if you do that, you have two integral from 0 to L over 2 rho of x, which is constant, is mass density per length. So you just take this and square that. So you have L cubed minus 6L squared plus 4x cubed squared dx. You need to square this and perform the integration. Plus m, so you have just one m, which is multiplied by this evaluated, in other words, this function evaluated at where the mass is. Since I took advantage of the symmetry and moved the origin here, mass is actually not located at x equal to 0. And that was actually the main reason to do that. So this would be just L cubed minus 6L squared x squared. 6LX squared, what did I do here? Okay. 6LX cubed plus 4X cubed squared, where X is equal to 0. That's your A, right? At that location. So it makes it easier. So basically this whole thing becomes M L to the 6. And this part, you can square that. Maybe I'll just write it down, that's okay. If you take the square root, take the integral, you get L to the 6 x plus 36 over 5 L squared x 5 plus 16 over 7 x seven minus four L four x cubed plus two L cubed x four minus eight L x six evaluated from zero to L over two. So that's what you have. So to simplify that, you end up with 0.4857 rho L to the seven plus M L six. That's mass equivalent.
That you end up. Yes.
Why did the x squared and 4x cubed evaluate?
Because you're evaluating this at AI, which is the location of the mass. Mass is located at x equal to zero. This is, you remember, okay, when you said, okay, these are lump masses. These were the distances from the origin that we are measuring, these masses. In this case, AI is zero. In other words, this is the distance. This is the x. So you're evaluating this at x equal to E's, at x equal to A1, A2, and so on. And since we took the origin in the center of the beam, A, which is x equal to A, is zero. Yes?
So would you have related the lumped part with the second graph and then the first, and then the continuous part with the first?
Oh, this is a general case, which we had set up many lump masses.
Oh, I mean in terms of the equation written.
This equation?
Yes.
Oh, this equation is for a simply supported beam. So in other words, if you have something like this, with many lump masses, okay, that's the equation that you use. Okay.
So I guess
you have only one mass here, though.
I guess what I'm just trying to say is, in this case, the continuous part is associated with the
beam.
the top graph.
The continuous part, this is associated with the beam itself, which has a distributed mass. This part associated with these lump masses, and you have only one of them in this case. Yes.
You only use the phi for the second graph. The first one is not related to this problem.
Maybe I should erase this, right? Is that what is causing the confusion? Yeah. This was just reminding you how we drove the equation, the Rayleigh's method and so on. So that's what we have here. That's the only. Any other questions? Okay. So let's simplify this. Well, we did. So let's now derive the k equivalent. K equivalent obviously is very easy because we have only the beam. So the k equivalent in this case, that equation, which I erased, right? No, I have it there. K equivalent would be also used, taking advantage of the symmetry, would be 0 to L over 2 of EI second derivative of phi with respect to x squared dx plus, we don't have this part because that's when we had multiple springs as support. So that's, so we only have this. So you just take the second derivative of this function, right? Second derivative of this, then square that. If you do that, you end up with two, and of course, I and E are constant, so you get this expression, minus 12 L plus 24 X squared dx. This is the second derivative of that phi of X. So you perform the integration, You get 144 L squared x plus 576 divided by 3 x cubed minus 576 divided by 2 L x squared from 0 to L over 2, and it results in 48 EI L cubed as the equivalent stiffness. So you have the equivalent mass, you have the equivalent stiffness, you can find the natural frequency. So let's see. In order to find the natural frequency, I'm going to consider two cases. Natural frequency would be change over that mass equivalent, right? So let's consider if that concentrated mass doesn't exist, and you're only looking at the natural frequency of a simply supported beam. In that case, you get natural frequency would be equal to 48 EI divided by 0.4857 rho L to the 4, okay? Which, comes by dividing this and that, right? So this can be further simplified to 9.941 EI over L to rho L to the 4. And I leave the L squared in there. So, L to the 4th in there. This is radians per second. There is a, in fact, book by, I forgot his first name, it's not Mike, by Blevins. Blevins did his PhD probably before I was born, I don't know, a long time ago. And he made a great contribution to the field of mechanical vibrations. He considered almost every possible simple physical structure using, of course, the continuous vibration of continuous systems approach. See, what we are studying in this course is basically the vibration of discrete systems. In other words, we assume that physical systems can be assumed to be made of lumped masses, each representing a degree of freedom. So based on that, we introduce, of course, single degree of freedom and multiple degree of freedom system and so on. But in reality, there is no such a thing as lumped mass. Every system is continuous, right? So you can actually use partial differential equations approach to, which is the foundation. In mechanical vibration, we use ordinary differential equation. In continuous system, we use partial differential equations, and you can actually derive the exact solution, not approximate solution, that's what we do here. The exact solution for vibration of all those physical systems. So like Blevins did, he did almost everything you can imagine, a beam, simply supported, cantilever, multiple supports, frames, you know, all kinds of things, and drove the exact solution for their natural frequencies and mode shapes, and tabulated those. And it's a book, probably 200 pages thick. It's like the Mark Handbook of Mechanical Engineering. I'm not sure if it is available now for free online or whatever, but it's a magnificent contribution. So in that book, if you go there, the natural frequency for a simply supported beam with a mass density of rho is tabulated, and I write that as the exact, as, if you look at it, is 9.869 EI over rho L to the 4. So if you compare the exact solution with the Rayleigh's solution, you see that the error that we have is about 0.7%. Not bad. I promise you, Rayleigh's method is very powerful. Yes?
His name was Robert.
Robert, thank you. Robert Blivens. I think he's done another, in fact, he did another major book, Flow-Induced Vibration. Another Bible.
Yeah. Foremost of dynamic acoustics and vibration.
Another Bible, Flow-Induced Vibrations, yeah. I mean, amazing guy. I'm not sure where he did his PhD in Pennsylvania somewhere. But yeah, definitely has made major contributions to the field. So if you now consider M is not zero, he considers that in the book. But that lump mass, let's consider that it's mass related to the density of the beam. For instance, if you have a rotating machinery, you would say, okay, the mass of that disc might be 3 times, 4 times, 5 times, whatever, multiples of the entire mass of the beam. So if you consider, for instance, this lump mass that we had, 3 times the total mass of the beam, which is significant. And that's usually the case. These disks, you have a rotor dynamic system. Think of the weight of the engine of an aircraft. It's massive, it's heavy, compared to the weight of the wing. It's more, a lot more than that. So if you make this assumption, the natural frequency would be 40 ABI over 3.4857 rho L to the 4, and that would be like 3.711 EI over rho L to the 4. And using using the exact solution, if the exact solution is tabulated as, okay, this is how he has tabulated it actually. It would be, okay. If you do the 3.7086 EI over rho L to the 4. And the error is about 0.065%. So, as I said, that really boggles your mind about Mr. Rayleigh and what he did. I would not expect the error in your case, depending on how good of a job you do. A couple of things that you need to do. First of all, you would use, I should tabulate it. Actually, I did that for the, oh no, I'm gonna do that, I haven't done that. When you choose your beam, you may consider, of course, simply supported or a cantilever. Cantilever, to be honest, is a lot easier. Because you can always find a piece of whatever, maybe steel ruler or some scrap metal, thin sheet metal, cut it and so on and consider that, and take a clamp and attach it to a heavy table, not something that would move, because then your measurement would be, would include some noise or some errors. So this is what I want you to do. I'll actually give you some clues how you want to do that. Let's say you consider something like this. Say this is so you have it. You have a cantilever beam. You have clamped it tightly here to a heavy table. So when your beam shakes, this is really not shaking at all. Let's say this is 1/4 of an inch, the thickness, the width is 1 inch, and the length is 27.1875. I had a 27.4.
1/8. About 1/8 of an inch. Yeah, about 1/8 of an inch.
Okay. And the mass density is given 0.283 pound per cubic inch.
I do not like these English units. This is pound force, right? So you have to convert that to slugs.
Pound mass,
right. So you gotta convert that to pound mass, right? Sorry. So you have to divide by what, 386, whatever. But anyway, E is 30 times 10 to the 6 PSI. And so I is the second moment of the area. It is just ironic, yeah, that we use the same notation for moment of inertia and the second moment of the area has nothing to do with that. And using the terminology of moment of inertia in statics, which is completely wrong, because you have no inertia in statics. You're only dealing with areas. So anyway, in statics, you know that the second moment of the area with respect to centroidal axis or the bending taking about this centroidal axis is what? If this is B, this is H, that would be it, right? So if this is vibrating, the bending is taking place about this is the neutral axis of the beam cross section. So that's your second moment of the area that you use in this formula. So let's do that for this beam. Okay. If you do that, you want to find, let's say, the exact solution. Exact solution is tabulated as this: 3.516 over L squared, the square root of E I over M bar. The notation M bar in that table, M bar is rho times cross-sectional area. Because this is derived not based on non-dimensional analysis. So that's why it is calculated like that. So that's what you will use. So let me show you, at least in this example, what you do. So you have, in this case, you have 3.516. Length is 27.1875. Squared, then E is 30 times 10 to the 6 PSI. I is 1/12 of B times 0.25 cubed, divided by rho is given as 0.283. So you need to multiply that by 12, this is per inch, so times 0.283 divided by, times, of course, the area, which is 1 times 1/4 divided by 386, which is for the conversion. Mass. And if you do that for this particular beam, you get 69.4418 radians per second, or if you convert that to hertz, would be 11.052 hertz. Believe it or not, I had used this example. Last time I taught the course, there was 18 who went out and found the exact same beam for their project to do it. So So because they had the answer. Yes.
So the units of m bar are math three.
Correct, yes. That's correct. So that's a good, that's an example. So this is what you need, because I forgot in the handout if to include that, or for that matter, actually, I don't think I included any exact formula for anything. So at least if you use a cantilever beam, this is the formula. If you use it, simply supported would be what I had here. Right. So, oh, not that one. The exact, this one. Okay. Any questions? So project you have 1 week. You should not spend more than $5, and you should document that you have not spent more than $5. And as far as the experimental approach, I leave it to you. You can do it a very sophisticated way, you know, or very simple. All you need is just a phone and some kind of a time measurement of move it through cyclic motion, free vibration, measure how many oscillations per second. That's it. Yes.
For that equation right there, where did you get the 12 and the 12 with the denominator?
Conversion to the because
B?
Right. Right.
Shouldn't it be 12 and a third then?
Yeah.
You got me. I don't know. I'm terrible with English. No, I think that's correct.
But it's just
because 386 over 12, right? No? 12 over 3.
Oh,
yeah. Yeah. Right. Any other questions? So let's see where we are. Maybe I can do another problem. I had another problem in mind, which is basically the extension of what I did earlier, just as a demonstration. So if you had something like this, let's say you have a spring now attached here. This is L over 2, this is O over 2, this is K. L, let's say, is 10 meter, which is a much more meaningful unit. K is 100 newton per meter. The cross section of, let's say, this beam is 1 centimeter by 10 centimeter. So I would be 1/12 of 10 times 1 cubed. E is given as 200 gigapascal, which is 200 times 10 to the 9 pascal, and rho is 7,860 kilogram per meter, cubic meters. Let's say you have something like this, and you want to find the natural frequency of that. So obviously we have a cantilever beam with a mass at the tip of it. Of course, the beam is not massless, but the assumed displacement shape or the mode of vibration would be assumed like that, so you can use this shape function that we've had before, 3/2 x over L cubed, squared minus 1/2 x over L cubed. So if you use that mass, the K equivalent now, and oh, by the way, K, I should give you that K value also. So you have integral from 0 to L, EI, second derivative with respect to X of phi squared dx plus
summation of K I phi squared at x is equal to d I. Okay. So that's K. That's the formula for equivalence difference. So let's substitute that. We get E I integral from 0 to L, 3 over L squared minus 3 to minus 2 over L cubed x squared dx plus k times bi, here is L over 2. K is located in the middle of the beam. So substitute that in phi of x, you get 3 half times 1 half minus 1 half times 1 half cubed squared. So if you just simplify that, you see this comes out to be just E I, okay? Okay, that would be E I, and this would be what? Yeah, 3 1/4, so 3/8 minus, yeah, 1/8, yeah, it becomes just E I plus K. And the mass equivalent would be just 0 to L of rho phi of x squared dx plus, in this case you have only one mass, so evaluated at phi at x equal to L. So I just write that down, okay? So that's what you have. Again, you perform the integration, substitute for, I mean, take this, square that phi of x, perform the integration, you get rho times 9 over 4 L to the 4th, integral from 0 to L of x4 dx plus 1 over 4 L to the 6, 0 to L of x6. I just took those components of the integral apart. 3, 2, L, 0 to L, x5 dx plus, this becomes 1, so it would be just plus m. So it would be 0.2357 rho L plus m. And this is K equivalent, this is the mass equivalent. And you just substitute those numbers and find the natural frequency. So the point is, you've seen now the power of Rayleigh's method, and that's all we wanted to demonstrate, that how Rayleigh's method can be used to approximate any physical system with a great accuracy, finding the fundamental natural frequency. So we have 5 minutes. Let's see where we are and where we are heading. I'm glad that I could honor my promise. I told you we spent about 3 weeks on modeling, right? So let's summarize where we are, because that is important where we are going. Okay? How many of you, you must know Yogi Berra? Right. His famous quote, you don't know where you're going. No, if you don't know where you're going, you'll never get there.
That's one of his famous quotes. He was actually a very bright, very genius. But, you know, he was a simple guy, decent, honest, good old, you know, typical, you know.
Tom Travers Square.
Yeah, not, nice guy, very simple guy. So the way he expressed himself, he was very, not very eloquent. Like one of his things he said was, always go to your friends' funerals, otherwise they won't come to yours. You remember that was your death, oh, how come they come? If you reinterpret it that way, how could they come to yours if they're all dead? But anyway, so that's where we are. So we don't know where we are going if we don't summarize where we are. So we introduced basically the concept of mechanical vibration, right? And we said that we will model everything, at least for the time being, as a single degree of freedom system by defining what a degree of freedom is. And in doing so, we said that the course will be now studying, at least 80% of the course, 90% of the course, studying either the free vibration of a single degree of freedom system or a forced vibration. And in each of these two cases, we consider the system being either undamped or damped. So we focus, our focus has been just this so far. We did, of course, solve the problem of free vibration of a single degree of freedom system. And the main reason we did that, we wanted to understand the most fundamental and most important concept or characteristic of a dynamic system, which is the natural frequency. Then we spent 3 weeks to just see how realistic actually it is to model a system as a single degree of freedom system. So we looked at three or four different approaches to model a physical system as a single degree of freedom system. In other words, to find its mass equivalent and K equivalent. A simple system using structural analysis, energy method, and of course the most powerful tool in energy method being Rayleigh's method. So the next step now, we are going to look at, based on the understanding and the solution that we have for the undamped free vibration of single degree of freedom systems, we're going to look at free vibration of a damped system. So in the differential equation now, we have an additional term, which is the damping force. And this is called the damping coefficient. So that's where we are going to start on Monday. Have a great weekend.
Group three. You're in group three.
That's the way to do it.